Hi, good evening. I'm Bradley Graham, the co-owner of Politics and Prose, along with my wife, Lisson. On behalf of the entire staff, welcome. Thank you for coming out on this rather threatening night. Couple of administrative notes before we get underway. If you have a cell phone, now would be a good time to turn it off. When we get to the question and answer part of this evening's talk, if you have a question, and we encourage everybody to ask something, please come up to one of the microphones at the front. There's one there, or there's one there, because we do record these events and post them on our website. And finally, at the end, before you rush up here to get your book signed, please help our staff by folding up the chairs that you're sitting in and leaning them against something solid somewhere. It's really a special treat for me to be introducing David Ignatius this evening, because he was the first author I introduced for an event here after acquiring the store. That was 3 years ago this week. And David is also an old friend. We overlapped many years at the Washington Post. And I know he's very familiar to many of you as a longtime and important figure on the Washington scene, and a frequent speaker here. He's appeared at PNP for each of his previous eight novels. As a journalist, David's columns in the Washington Post remain a must-read for anyone following national security affairs or global politics or economics. Not only is he exceptionally well-connected, he actually goes out and reports on many of the things that he writes about, whether in war zones or international conferences or in the offices and homes of his many sources around the world. His novels have grown out of his journalism. They're rooted in the same expert reporting that infuses his columns, reporting especially about the shadowy world of international espionage. I've kidded David before that when you finish one of his books, you're never quite sure how much may have actually happened, or is happening, or may be about to happen. And in his latest novel, The Director, it's no different. Once again, David's come up with a riveting plot that plays on some very current dangers and seems highly plausible, all too frighteningly plausible. This time, the story turns on the vulnerability of governments and financial institutions to cybercrime, surveillance, and digital warfare. The book offers some fascinating glimpses into the hacker community and also into how spies are now doing battle in the digital domain. As I told David after reading The Director, I did appreciate seeing an old-fashioned bookstore turn up in chapter 28. It's nice to remind readers that we still exist and that even computer nerds need to look stuff up on the shelves of bricks and mortar stores now and then. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming David Ignatius.
Thank you to Brad. This is special for me. It is the ninth time that I've been at this podium, but it's even more special with Brad and Lisa as the owners. This bookstore is a great institution of our city, and when Brad and Lisa took it over, they gave it their energy and new life, and it's one of the successes that I most enjoy watching. I've known Brad since early in my career at the Washington Post. Like a lot of my colleagues, I couldn't really believe there was somebody at the Washington Post named Bradley Graham. I mean, that must be a made-up name. And Brad and I worked together on the foreign desk. We were just talking a few moments ago about when the Gulf War, which we ran the desk for, ended in 1991. We went back to my house in Cleveland Park and we poured a great big Scotch whiskey and we toasted the fact that we'd gotten the paper through it. I have to say to all of you to come out on a night when there is a tornado watch. This audience either really loves books or is a little bit nuts. And I am going to try to make sure not to talk too long and to sign my name very quickly if people want me to autograph books. But I really do appreciate people turning out. This has been a wonderful week for the author because, frankly, you don't get in your career too many reviews like the one that appeared in the Washington Post this week. And, you know, to be honest, I've had enough bad reviews, even on this book, that really just was an incredible moment for me. It began with my wife, Eve, who's sitting in the third row, saying, has breakfast earlier than I do, David, have you read the Washington Post review yet? And me going, what? Years ago, I got a review.
I buried the lead. I'm sorry. I was supposed to, I meant to report, too, that we just learned that David's book has made the extended New York Times bestseller list.
So that's... I just heard that from my agent, Raphael Segalin, who was also here in the audience. The list came out at 6 tonight, and at 6:01 thereabouts, I heard from Rafe. So that was nice. Anyway, if you are really feeling like you want to buy some books, Philip Kerr is a really good novelist, and he also writes pretty good reviews. So. So every time that I've come here after publishing a book, I've read briefly from my novels. In truth, the only place that I really read, I'm going to talk about the book in a few minutes, but I did want to read one passage in part to tell you about the sort of serendipitous process by which a novel comes together. The chapter that I'm going to read is not about the hero of the book, whose name is Graham Weber, who was the director of the title, who comes to CI wanting to change it, wanting to reform it, wanting to take it out of a past that he thinks is haunting the institution. And it's not about his foil in this book, the sort of super geek, whose name is James Morris, who is, I hope, an interesting character for people. It's about a character named Ramona Kyle, who is a passionate libertarian, who is the closest and maybe the only friend that James Morris, this technical wizard at the CIA to whom the director turns in crisis, maybe the only friend that he really has. We meet her in the beginning of the book in Las Vegas in a very brief and elliptical glimpse, and we next see her in Washington at the Jefferson Memorial weeping as she looks up at the words from our libertarian president, Thomas Jefferson, and thinks about what's happening to the country. And then in the chapter that I'm going to read to you, we see deeper into her and what she's up to. The reason I want to read this is that it was added to the book only several months ago. The book had already been completed. Bound copies had been sent to reviewers. It was finished. I mean, you know, books have this long gestation period, but this one was over. And I kept ruminating about the issues that we were seeing as the Snowden revelations played out. And this book, is meant to be a post-Snowden novel. And I realized that I had a little bit more to say about that, and that the way to say it was through this character, Ramona Kyle. So I'm going to read briefly from this chapter that was added in the second set of galleys that were sent to people, and then I'll tell you more about the book and how it came to be. This chapter is set in Silverton, Colorado. If you've ever been to the western range of Colorado, it's a wild place that I happened to go once, so I knew it just well enough to think I could describe it. From the window of Ramona Kyle's cabin, she could see the old mining town sewn like a cross stitch into the valley below. The trees on her hillside were shimmering golden red, the leaves swirling down Highway 110 toward the north end of town. In every direction were the jagged teeth of the San Juan Mountains, guarding the western gate of the Rockies. Kyle's cabin was up near the tree line amid the gray rock that reached almost to the October sky. Nobody with any sense lived here. The highway north from Durango had already been closed once by early snow. In a few weeks, this place would be the perfect desolation, populated only by recluses and daredevils. She was an elfin figure, sitting in a wing chair by the big window, her red hair gathered in a frizzy ponytail, a magazine across her lap. This was her hiding place, an address no one knew on a country road that even the locals rarely visited. At the San Juan County Courthouse on Green Street, a few miles below, a deed was registered for the cabin, but it wasn't in her name or traceable to anything she owned. The same was true of her satellite internet connection, which was her only requirement here, other than the space and the silence. Here she could be no one and nowhere. She thought about James Morris. He was someone and everywhere, enfolded in a world she despised. She had launched him, but she suspected that he was as oblivious of his ultimate purpose as a spinning metal bullet of its target. He took his actions without understanding their consequences. He was innocent in that way, precious and alone. She wanted to protect him. A burning log crackled in the fireplace behind her. Kyle rose from her chair and put more wood on the grate, poking at the embers until the flame rose nearly to the damper. Above the fireplace was a Renaissance painting she'd bought from a dealer in Florence a year ago after she'd sold her interest in an Italian startup. It was a minor work from the school of a second-rank painter in Padua, but it appealed to Kyle. It showed the martyrdom of Saint Sebastian, the man tied to a tree and pierced with arrows. There was in the martyr's eyes a look of helpless surrender, almost quizzical, not joy, but submission. After she bought the painting, she had researched Sebastian's improbable life. His Roman friends were butchered gruesomely. One by one, Zoe hung by her heels over a fire until she choked. Tarquilinus, stoned to death. Castellus, racked and buried alive. Tibertus, beheaded. Sebastian refused to flee. A quiver of arrows pierced every limb, but even then he didn't die. He confronted the emperor and spoke out in his agony, taunting Diocletian for his cowardly murder of the Christians until he was finally beaten to death and silence. Kyle returned to her chair. The sun had broken through the lowering afternoon sky, illuminating the whole of the town. The outcroppings of Kendall Peak, which rose from the high valley, were bathed in white sunlight, while the dells and crevices fell into a deep shadow of silver black. It would be snowing again soon over Coal Pass and Mola Pass, perhaps closing the two-lane road into Silverton once more. Kyle felt selfish. A person could live and die here with the dignity of a wild animal. She was letting James Morris do the dirty business, requiring it of him, in truth. Kyle had given up on half measures. She had concluded over the last several years that America could not change course. The forces of oppression had captured the state so completely that they were the state. The people were the subjects of a tyrannical power that couldn't be reformed or appeased, but only destroyed. The clouds were darkening over the San Juan Range. The sunlight had vanished as quickly as it had come. She picked up the magazine she'd been reading. It was Spectrum, the journal of the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineering. The cover story she had been reading was titled, "Would You Shoot Your Neighbor's Drone?" That was what the world was coming to. Even the geeks were becoming fascists. Kyle put the magazine aside and closed her eyes. So the one reason I wanted to read that is because if you know anything about my work, you know that the views that that character is expressing are really not my own. If you read what David Ignatius has to slice into 750 word pieces in his op-ed columns. You know that on the question of Snowden, as I'll say later, I've taken a quite different position. But the joy for me of fiction, people always ask me, you know, why do you do both things? How do you do both things? The joy for me of writing fiction is that you don't have to slice it into those little pieces, and that you can let yourself ruminate on what someone like the woman I just described to you would think, and by implication, what a whole world of people who share that view think, and let yourself be inside their views, not your own, and let the subject that Snowden has introduced that I'll talk about, be as complicated as it is in real life, without having to keep score, you know, assign, you know, a yes, no, up, down, yay, boo, at the end of 750 words, which is what I have to do twice a week. So if anybody wonders, you know, what's the pleasure of fiction, it's in part because you can let life be as complicated as it is. I want to say a few words about how I came to write this book. People assume, because, as I say, it's a post-Snowden novel and it comes out in a time when we've been living through all these issues, that, as Brad was hinting, gosh, what Snowden must have called me up and told me he was looking for the download key on his computer. In truth, I began this book at the beginning of 2012 on the assumption that ahead for the country was some kind of collision between the world of espionage, the world of these huge intelligence bureaucracies, and the world of hackers, which was beginning to fascinate me. So I did what has been my habit with every one of my novels, which was to begin doing research. And you may have heard me talking on the radio about that. I won't go into great detail, but I went out to the biggest hackers convention, you know, a wonderful concept of a hackers convention. Needless to say, the hackers, like everybody else, hold their big conventions in Las Vegas. It's what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas unless it gets hacked. They hold their convention. If anybody here knows Las Vegas, they know the Rio Hotel, which is across the interstate, and is a little bit kind of raunchy. There's Caesar's Palace, the really nice, you know, kind of, and then there's the Rio, and then you're kind of entering a different world. So I trooped over there with my guide, a wonderful man, I'll give a plug to, named Matt DeVos, who was a leading computer science technician, and he would say a white hat hacker. And as in the beginning of my novel, his first words to me when I proposed this were, okay, great, you know, I'll take you around, but don't bring your cell phones. Don't bring any computers, because as soon as you get there, they'll be hacked. You know, you think, okay, fine, I'll leave them behind. You arrive at this big Las Vegas hotel. You see people, the likes of which, you know, you'd never see at any convention you could imagine. I mean, they've got, you know, mohawk spiky hair. In fact, there was a booth there. You know, if you wanted your own mohawk, I was really tempted, believe me. But I don't really have enough hair to have a good mohawk. Kids in crazy t-shirts, kids who looked radically unhealthy, you know, all kind of swirling around. If you can imagine 15,000 people who were hackers who have all gotten together to talk about this. As I've mentioned, you walk into the convention space and you're confronted with a scroll on a screen which is listing in real time all of the usernames and passwords that are being hacked in that moment. I mean, it's just you realize how completely vulnerable you are, and you know the lectures that they give at this convention are just startling. They're basically about how to hack, you know, encrypted cloud computing systems, how to hack codes on elevators, how to hack drones, in fact, as in the example I use. There's really nothing that isn't open to clever young people who want to go after this as a kind of sport. And there are a lot of games at this convention to where people compete to get into servers, to get into your email account, to get into my email account, to get into the things that we think are our private spaces. You know, what I often say about these NSA scandals that Snowden revealed is that in part it was the fact that NSA was clever enough to go to this convention for a decade and recruit the very smartest of these kids in black t-shirts, you know, the ones who win the contest to get inside the completely impenetrable spaces. You know, those were kids that they brought to the NSA. When I went to Fort Meade researching the book, I was amazed to see some of the kids in the halls who looked like they just had walked off this convention floor. And I do think that's, you know, when you want to understand how it is that the NSA came to be such a pervasive force, you know, with a kind of surveillance that none of us could have really imagined, I think you have to combine this hacker mentality, if you can get inside of it, do that just partly for the sport of it, with of this vast secret bureaucracy that really doesn't have adequate supervision and oversight. So, you know, that combination proved especially toxic. So I was working on this book through 2012 into 2013. I'm finishing my first draft last summer, and all of a sudden, a year ago, this person named Edward Snowden begins revealing in the Washington Post and other newspapers a kind of secret that, you know, is the sort of thing that you know, intelligence agencies most fear the disclosure of. These communications and cryptological secrets are the ones that they most try to protect. And suddenly, you know, day after day, week after week, they were coming out. And one thing that I thought, I had lots of complicated reactions, which I wrote about in my columns, but one thing I thought was, gee, David, you really need to write a second draft for your book, because real life has just suddenly leaped forward and is so interesting, and what Snowden is telling us about how the world really works in secret and the ways in which these tools, you know, as I was imagining them, could be turned back against the United States, could be turned back against the CIA itself, just needed much more attention than I'd given. So I wrote a second draft. I gave that draft to a lot of people. One of them was my wife. I'm not going to tell the whole of this story. My wife is sitting in the third row next to next to one of my three daughters. But I gave it to Eve and asked Eve, do you think it's there yet? And she, as I've said to other audiences, gave me the gift that is the hardest to give to someone that you love, which is to say, it's not good enough. You need to do better. You know, if you're ever asked by someone you love for an opinion, really remember this story, because it's, you know, all of us think, you know, nobody really in those situations wants to tell the truth. We want to, you know, make the people we love happy by saying, it's great. Oh, you worked so hard on it. It's really so much better than it was. And you know, the truth is that there are times when we just have to be honest and say, you need to try one more shot at this. So the book that you're reading, the book that, you know, it just hit the bestseller list tonight, and, you know, really is the product of somebody saying, it's not there yet. So this is a shout out to my wife. So I want to finally just say a few words about the Snowden case. Again, if you read my columns, you know pretty much what I think. It's very hard for me to see Edward Snowden as a hero. He is somebody who was entrusted with just about the biggest secrets our country has. And he took an oath that he would protect them. And he has said that he made efforts to blow the whistle internally. We'll see. You know, what's come out so far is it's not conclusive on that issue, but he says that that's so, and you'd certainly want him to do that. When I talk to people in the intelligence community, especially at a time like this, where we're seeing terrorists, people really who would do us harm, explosively on the rise again in Iraq. I mean, it just sickens me. Somebody like Brad, who spent many, many, many days, watching the terrible devastation of the war in Iraq, the series of wars in Iraq. You know, but the Al-Qaeda at least was gone from the Euphrates Valley. Well, it's back. It's not just back. It's now dominating the whole of northern Iraq. And, you know, I hope that we're able to make better decisions about the next 10 years of this struggle than we did about the last 10. I hope so. But I do know we're going to need a solid intelligence community, and so I worry about that. I worry about the damage this has done in America's alliances. People, when I travel in Germany, all over Europe, I find people are shocked in a way that that's painful for me as an American. I think they really couldn't imagine that we would do this, that we would be so intrusive in their view. Also, I think a part of it is there is a latent anti-Americanism in the world that's been waiting for opportunities to surface. It's just there, and it's very much alive. So that, you know, that worries me. It worries me, I think, most of all, that in the aftermath of these disclosures, everybody's trying to lock down everything. The Europeans are determined to protect privacy. There's this fascinating case that a European has brought in which he's basically saying, I should be able to delete aspects of my past online. I shouldn't, you know, this shouldn't live forever. I should have control over my life as it's recorded online. You know, that's something, it's fascinating. I'd be happy to talk about it more in question and answer. But my fear is that the internet, which has been this incredible transforming technology in which information is as pervasive as the air. Wherever you go around the world, you have access to it instantly. It doesn't have borders. It doesn't have boundaries. It doesn't have controls. You know, it turns out it was being surveilled in ways that we couldn't have imagined, but it was open and free and drove this new world. My fear is that already countries are seeking to put up fences to keep out the NSA, to keep out the, you know, this intruder, that security service, and that they, you know, we have lived through the golden age of this technology, and that going forward, I think it's going to be at least for a while much tighter with regulations that may be difficult to live with. So the final thing I want to say, and I often close my conversations by talking about this. At the end of the day, each of us has to make up our own minds how we balance the damaging aspects of the technology, but also of the disclosures about it, against the obvious benefit that we have learned what our government was doing. We've learned that the fears of my character, Ramona Kyle, that I began this reading with, the fears that we have an intrusive government that is sabotaging the things that our country is supposed to stand for, we now are having a debate about how to reform that. And I remind myself that on this question of how to balance our privacy, our personal rights against issues of security, the things that intelligence services worry about, we couldn't have clearer instructions from the people who founded our country and wrote our Constitution and the Bill of Rights. Their basic message was, beware of big government. You know, they were frightened. They had just broken from a monarchy that had been dictatorial, autocratic, had abused the colonies, and they felt with a passion that is the driving force of the Constitution, that you have to be wary of this, no matter what purposes it claims, no matter what good end it supposedly is for. So, again, as I said at the outset, if you read my columns, you know I have my own complicated feelings about this. But I think my bottom line is that privacy, caring about individual rights, fear of big government really is in our DNA. It's sort of part of what makes us Americans. And we're just going to have to live with some risks that other kinds of countries like China or Russia don't live with, because they're not, they don't have that same DNA. So as you read the book, you'll see that the author, for once, unlike in his columns, didn't have to say at the bottom, you know, check this box. He just let his story roll. I hope you'll read it, and I hope the book will come alive again in your imaginations as you go through it. I'd be happy to take questions, as Brad said, from anybody about anything that I write about or that's on your mind. And I think you're supposed to, anybody who wants to ask a question should line up at a microphone. And if there's nobody who wants to ask a question and you want to get away from the tornado, that's very smart. And anybody, I won't be hurt if anybody walks out, because I'll think you're very sensible people. But if anybody does want to ask a question, please do come to the microphones.
Thank you. You mentioned there was a latent anti-American attitude in the world. Could you expand on that? Is that based more on envy for our success or our own policies?
A character in the books says, or maybe it's the narrator, that there's a dangerous combination that we have managed to produce over these last 10 years of our invading Iraq, toppling a government there, toppling a government in Afghanistan, and not succeeding in stabilizing the country under new leadership. So we're seen, I think, in many parts of the world as aggressive, an arrogant superpower, but also as an unsuccessful superpower. And I think that combination is particularly dangerous. People at once are angry at us and also a little bit contemptuous of us. And I think that's part of what's surfacing. There are many things about President Obama's foreign policy that bother me. But I think the desire to try to find a way back to balance and, you know, good alliances with our friends and a reputation of the world that's more positive, is, I think he's absolutely right about the importance of that. We are just too unpopular in the world today. It's what's one of the sad things about the Snowden affair is that at a time we were already really unpopular, along came this that reinforced anybody who had, you know, the slightest concerns about American abuse of power looks at this and is convinced that we're, you know, really not a good country. Yes, ma'am.
There's an old story from World War II that a chaplain once told me, that even in England, the British would say about the Americans that you're overpaid, oversexed, and over here. And that remains true. I thoroughly enjoyed Body of Lies. Anybody who does a parody of the Operation Mincemeat is just great in my book. You had a column on the ALSUPs last week, which was very good. And the previous day, George Will had a column in which he quoted Winston Churchill and Saxby Chambliss. Do you think the Republican conservative foreign policy expertise is kind of scraping the bottom of the barrel at this point?
Well, that's it's a good question to ask on the day after Eric Cantor got toppled. I mean, what an amazing period this is. We have a White House that's in some difficulty, I think any observer would say. We have a Republican leadership that's just reeling. This is going to be an interesting turbulent period. But I appreciate your mentioning the earlier book, and Operation Mincemeat. I'll give a plug for another great book that's coming by the author of Operation Mincemeat and a previous book about Operation Double Cross, which was the way the British MI5, you know, turned and ran all of Germany's agents in Britain. Incredible story. This author, Ben McIntyre, has a new book called The Great Betrayal about the Philby story, which is just astonishing to see what a mess MI6 made of that case from, you know, from beginning basically until the day before Philby fled Beirut for Moscow. It's just so it's a wonderful book, Ben McIntyre. It'll be out in July. I'm going to review it in the Washington Post, and I can tell you I like it a lot. Yes, please.
Hi. I've been trying to figure out where I am on the Snowden thing, and I was pretty adamantly against him, and for the most part am, but two things made me try to figure this out. One was a sort of damning frontline piece. I don't know if you saw that. Really talked about the Snowden case, and it reminded me about how a lot of people in power went to the FICA courts, and how the judge on the FICA court was kind of coerced into overturning some of the decisions there. And then the second thing was, I saw the journalist, I can't even think of his name now, who broke the story at Sixth and I. Mm-hmm. And one of the things he said.
Yes, Glenn Greenwald.
Yeah. Yeah, Greenwald, yes, thank you. And it surprised me when he said that Snowden had him vet everything that he released for in terms of harming national security. I hadn't really heard that piece before, so yeah. I was glad he did that. But I wondered, even with that vetting, you know, that movie that was made on the Julian Assange case showed how many lifetime career foreign officers' careers were destroyed by that kind of release of information. And do you think that's happened in this case?
I'll just cite fact and then give you my opinion on this question of damage. If you read my column, you may have seen that I interviewed last week James Clapper, the director of National Intelligence, who doesn't give interviews very often, but did in this case, and who said on the record in what I quoted that the damage that Snowden had caused, while he said it was profound, was less than they had initially thought, and the reason is that, again quoting him. Some things that they thought he had taken, and for a long time, I have to tell you, as a journalist, I kept at. They didn't know. They really didn't know how extensive the damage was. They were just. It was like groping in the dark, and they had managed to reconstruct enough of the kind of classified web that he was trolling in to have a better sense of what he got and what he didn't. And according to Clapper, some things that he wanted to that he looked at, he couldn't download or didn't download. So that's the good news. The bad news, you could say, is according to the senior intelligence official who I quoted, he downloaded 1.5 million documents, but that's not as bad as they thought it was. I honestly think that it's going to take some time for all of us to sift, the implications of this. I mean, you know, we have new legislation that I think is going to be passed and signed that's going to change the way in which information about us, about Americans, is held. And I think all of us, I suspect, would think that's a good thing. Personally, and again, I suspect most people agree with me. I do want the government, if somebody from Al Qaeda in Mosul is calling a number in the United States, I do want our government to be able to figure out who that person is calling and why. Hopefully these reforms will protect our privacy, but also allow for that job to go forward. You know, if another thing that the intelligence officials said in this article is they're open to some kind of discussion with Snowden about that would allow him to come back and face trial or some kind of legal proceeding, you know, what we normally call it a plea agreement, if he makes a full disclosure of what he did. And one reason that I think that's a good idea is I don't know that we're going to have a clear sense of the totality of this story without that kind of independent. And that's what trials are great at. They establish the factual record so we know what happened. And I think that would be in everybody's interest. In truth, it would be in Snowden's interest. So I hope that happens.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hi, Mr. Ignatius. My question is with regards to Iraq and Afghanistan, kind of in retrospect. So given the issues that we've faced recently there, do you think that Vice President Biden was correct in the sense of opposing opposing the surge in Afghanistan and also favoring a kind of a partition type a situation in Iraq? Do you think
yes.
he was right?
So I'll repeat the question. Given what's happening in Iraq, the decomposition of Iraq, was Biden right to advocate, as he did years ago, the partition? He said basically we should let it fall into the three ethnic pieces. And second, was Biden right to oppose President Obama's decision to send an additional 30,000 troops to Afghanistan in the so-called surge? Let me take the Iraq issue first. What I wrote at the time, and I still believe deeply, is that whether Iraq splits into three parts or not is not for the United States to say. I mean, that's the mistake that we made, really, in going in there and in an invasion that, at the end of the day, I say, because I have deep regret about this, I support it. And I think its consequences for Iraq, for the Middle East, for the United States, have really been extremely negative. You know, it as somebody said to me the other day, it opened the gates of hell in Iraq, and those gates really haven't been closed. But you know, the Iraqi people and nation are going to have to decide: can they live as one? They need better leadership than they've got in al-Maliki, who I think has been a total disaster. What I objected to was the idea that we decide, okay, it's now convenient for us, for this country, to dissolve into three. Afghanistan, I found the election in Afghanistan encouraging. I think Abdullah, the likely next president, is going to be a figure who will be a much better leader, you know, by light years than Karzai has been. I think people who assume that Afghanistan will just slip back into its past. You know, it's a commonplace for people to say, oh, well, you know, it's basically just lives in the 15th century, and, you know, it's just, you know, what do we think we're doing? And I go to Afghanistan often. I've been there with our troops. I've been there with, you know, on my own for a number of years now. And the idea that we're just going to re-loop the movie back to the Taliban and the Civil War, I don't think is right. I mean, I could be wrong about that, but Afghanistan has been transformed. I mean, the most obvious example is the rights of women. The, you know, women are now being educated in primary and secondary school, increasingly in university. It's a different place. It's become an urban country. Something like 60% of the population, this was a primitive place, now has a cell phone. 80% watch television every week. I mean, it's a different country. I'm not saying that 30,000 additional American troops made good things happen, but we did add a degree of stability. And the Taliban is not popular in Afghanistan. I mean, you see that they do intimidate people, but they're not popular. And you know, I this is a place where I hope going forward they'll have more stability. They certainly deserve it. And I personally would be happy if President Obama was more open-ended about what's ahead in the future, rather than promising that, you know, every troop will be gone by such and such a date. Let's let, you know, conditions and circumstances decide that. That would be what I'd say. Yes.
Thank you. I really appreciate your work and read it religiously. What I wanted to ask you is, I've met really talented computer activists from all over the world, every bit as competent as Edward Snowden. Why do you think there hasn't been more cyber terrorism in this country? And, you know, just to put a little editorial comment in there, I would assert I'm really glad that the United States has a variety of systems to try and protect against the worst scenarios.
Well, I share your, I'm happy that we have the ability to know what's coming at us. I hope we can do this in a way that is less invasive for us as citizens, and also begins to extend to people around the world. You know, they're not going to be American citizens. They won't have the Fourth Amendment. But if there's some way that we can say, we respect your privacy rights as citizens of the world. Privacy is a universal global value, and, you know, here's what we're going to do to protect it. I think that's very much what Obama and his advisors on this have been trying to do. You know, one problem in this, you know, world of ever more aggressive cyber espionage is that it's really much easier for authoritarian governments like China and Russia to navigate this than it is for democracies. I mean, you know, they're just steaming ahead. And you know, from their standpoint, these revelations about how terrible America is, I mean, how wonderful that's been. That's a concern. I think we're just going to have to live with. I started today at a breakfast with some foreign government officials who were looking at the question of oversight of their intelligence agencies and intelligence issues generally. And one thing that emerged in our discussion was the enormous gap between the United States, where, you know, we talk about this stuff constantly. I mean, you know, because we have an aggressive Washington Post and New York Times, you know all about what our government agencies are doing, whereas people in other countries know almost nothing. I mean, there just is no public discussion in Germany and France and in most countries of what intelligence agencies do. They're secret, and they're meant to be, let alone China and Russia. So, you know, that one of the problems now is this huge gap between an increasingly open and, I hope, transparent United States, where we talk about these things, we pass laws, we have oversight, we have courts that have, you know, exercise legal oversight, and the rest of the world where that's just not the case. That worries me a lot. Yes, sir.
Hi there. I'd be interested in your observations on the Bergdahl swap and the suggestion we gave up too much. And then secondly, on the your thoughts on the administration's decision to ignore the law regarding notification of Congress about it.
You know, the first thing I would say about the Bergdahl swap is anybody who follows these issues, and that certainly includes leading members of Congress who are raising such objections now, anyone who was surprised by this swap just wasn't paying attention. It has been under discussion, including the names of those who would be released, for at least 2 years. It's been widely discussed. I have been writing columns about the swap, about Bergdahl, it's been known for at least 2 years to anybody who cared that Bergdahl walked away from his unit. That also is not a secret, and it has been widely discussed. And, you know, if members of Congress were agitated about it, there was certainly the opportunity to say so. You know, they did pass a law saying they wanted to be notified. And the president, when in signing it, issued a signing statement saying, this is an inappropriate infringement on my powers as commander-in-chief, and I don't accept its you know that this is a binding and appropriate law. I think it's unconstitutional. Basically, is what he was saying. You know, that doesn't make it right the president shouldn't break laws, but he did say he thought it was unconstitutional. I suspect he would be upheld on that, personally, but we'll see. I don't think that going AWOL or even deserting means that you lose your rights as a citizen. And people who imply that it would have been okay just to leave him there in this cage, in Miramshah or wherever the Haqqani network was holding him, I don't agree with that. I do think that the United States had a responsibility, even to this person who walked away from his unit, to try to bring him back. And if you want to test that, just play the counterfactual. Imagine that President Obama hadn't made this swap, and it's a year from now, and we see a video in which he's either, you know, dying, pleading for his freedom, or he's being beheaded, you know, which is not a fanciful scenario given. And imagine people saying, do you mean to say, Mr. President, that you had an opportunity to swap, you know, prisoners in Guantanamo, who we just to get this American back home, and you didn't do it? And people would be shocked. So, you know, I think when he comes out of Landstuhl and he probably is going to stand trial in a military court that will examine whether he's guilty of something. But I don't think that means that we shouldn't have brought him back. In this case, I agree. It's a rare moment when I agree totally with Charles Krauthammer.
He's also spoken at
Well, he's a colleague, but we don't agree all the time. Suffice to say, but on this he was totally correct on the question of whether the price was too high, which is the other part of your question. That these are the five people that the Taliban said were the price. You know, they these were the names that they circulated. It's the first time they mentioned these names, I believe, was in November 2010. Secretary Clinton, in February 2011, opened a public dialogue about negotiations with the Taliban that would include this. This was always seen as the beginning of a process that would lead to discussions about an overall political settlement of the war, in which the Taliban would, in effect, come to the bargaining table and we would agree on process going forward after the departure of American troops. That hasn't happened. Is it still possible? I don't know. I guess because I do think these are seriously dangerous Taliban figures, two of whom had an al-Qaeda facilitation role, the question we should be asking is, how are we going to make sure that they don't leave Qatar, go back, in effect, to the battlefield and kill more Americans, or Afghans, for that matter. But one of the most interesting commentaries on this has been written by a Republican, former State Department legal advisor, former NSC lawyer, John Bellinger, St. Albans alum, like me, and a fine person. And John Bellinger wrote, basically, you have to, if you're going to look at this seriously, you have to consider the possibility that it will soon be illegal to be holding these people. I mean, once American troops really leave Afghanistan, and this, you know, the authorization to use military force under which all this has been framed is gone. They would have been gone anyway. So you could argue, since they're, you know, at some point in the near future, they would be leaving Guantanamo no matter what. It's good that we got something for them. I don't see any more people.
One more?
Yes, sir.
50 years from now, how will historians assess the motives of the Bush-Cheney administration for taking us into Iraq?
Well, historians. Brad? Sorry. That's why Diet Coke is so great, because it really is that fizzy. Motives, I really can't. It's hard for me to know what their motives were. I think historians will judge very harshly the wisdom of the decision. The reasons that were advanced, Iraqi WMD possession, proved to be bogus, and so in that sense we went to war on a false pretext. But at a much deeper level, this was so flawed. I mean, what was the idea of knocking out the Sunni world's main restraining wall, if you will, against an expansionist revolutionary Iran? What was the idea there? What did we think was going to happen? And I think there was a sort of romanticism about democratic change, which characterized the Bush administration to a surprising extent. I wrote once about Paul Wolfowitz that, his fundamental mistake in Iraq was that he was too idealistic, and people denounced me. This was like, it was part of the case against David. But I mean this in the sense that he was, idealistic in believing that democratic transformation, the enfranchisement of the Shiite majority in Iraq would create this new country that would, I think the belief was it will lead the democratic revolution in the region. And that was just so mistaken. And we're living with the horrific consequences of it. And the next chapter, I'm writing my column about this tomorrow, so you can read what I think is the next chapter on Friday. But we're really going to have to think very carefully about what we're going to do about a part of the world that is just ripping at the seams. These countries are all coming apart in violent ways, and Al Qaeda is filling the gaps in Syria, in Iraq. I mean, Al Qaeda has just, their flag is flying 3 miles from the Baghdad airport. Their flag is flying all over Syria. I just, people may know I snuck into Syria. I saw Al Qaeda foreign fighters near me as I was traveling. I was going to sneak into Syria again a few weeks ago from Jordan, and one reason people stopped me was that the Al Qaeda affiliate is now just across the Jordanian border. And it's set up checkpoints on these roads. It's a terrible problem. It is a problem. Al Qaeda was there before we invaded Iraq. Al Qaeda was a serious problem we're going to have to deal with. But there's no question that having knocked out the pegs of all these regimes and created power vacuums is ending up enfranchising the scariest people in the world. And we're going to have to, unfortunately, we're all sick of dealing with this stuff, but we're going to have to think about how we help our friends stay afloat. So there's a cheery note to end on. So I want to just thank everybody for coming and...